Good morning. I want to welcome everyone. I'm Senator David Carlucci, and I have the distinct honor and privilege of serving as the chairman of the Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities Committee in the New York State Senate. And I want to thank everyone for being here today for this extremely important conversation that we're going to have dealing with eating disorders. And as all of you know, that unfortunately in the United States, we have over 20 million women and 10 million men that are living with an eating disorder. And we all know that with the right treatment, with the right help, with fighting the stigma attached with mental illness and eating disorders, that we can really turn things around and get people on the right track to recovery, to a healthy and productive life. We know that, unfortunately, when we talk about mental illness and we talk about eating disorders, that eating disorders are the leading cause of mortality with people with mental illness. In fact, every 62 minutes, or approximately every hour, one American passes away in a direct relation to eating disorders. So we need to make sure that we get a handle on this. I know I'm talking to the right people. Our committee, the Mental Health Committee in the New York State Senate, is ready to introduce a robust package of legislation in this coming legislative session. And the idea here today is to work together to talk about some of the gaps in the system, talk about some of the experiences that we've seen, that we've experienced, and make sure that New York State is really leading the way in terms of making sure that we have the legislation that's going to make a difference. And one of the things that's most exciting to me about this hearing today is that we know that there's so much that can be done. And we know that this is something that with the right help, with the right type of treatment, that we can really change things and improve the quality of life. So many of you I've met before, particularly Hannah, who's here from Briarcliff, someone that came into my office earlier this year and shared with me her story. And I asked her, she put together this presentation. I said, is this for college? Is this for school? And she said, no, this is so I can share my story. And I just thank her and all the people like Hannah that have been so articulate with really sharing this story, taking it out of the dark, putting it into the light, and making sure that that story is told so that other people have a chance. And the stories that she shared with me were shocking and really unraveled what we saw. Hey, we can bring our laws into the 21st century, and New York State can be a leader. So with that, I'm looking forward to asking some questions and having a great dialogue. Assemblyman Felix Ortiz is on his way. He's traveling from Brooklyn, so we won't hold that against him. I know he's fighting the traffic to get over here, but we figured we'd start, and we have this recorded. It's on the record, and we're looking forward to everyone's presentation today. So with that, we'll start with Samantha Fletcher, Dr. Samantha Fletcher from the National Association of Social Workers. Samantha?
Thank you.
Thank you.
So like you just said, my name is Samantha Fletcher, and I'm the executive director at the National Association of Social Workers for the New York State chapter. I would like to thank Senator Carlucci and the other members of the Committee on Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities for the invitation to testify today. It is an honor and a privilege to be here and represent our membership, as well as the nearly 58,000 licensed social workers in the state. Eating disorders are complex and are rooted in both genetic and environmental influences. Approximately 1 in 20 females are impacted by eating disorders over the course of their lifetime. For young women between the ages of 15 to 24, eating disorders are in the top 4 leading causes of death and disability. Individuals diagnosed with anorexia nervosa are 12 times more likely to die by suicide than the general population. Similarly, suicide risk is also increased with diagnosis of bulimia nervosa and binge eating disorders. Eating disorders often occur with other mental health disorders, including anxiety, depression, mood disorders, personality disorders, and/or substance abuse disorders, indicating that treatment approaches must address all of these issues as well as the underlying environmental factors. Identifying and treating the early onset of an eating disorder promises a significantly better chance of recovery. It requires an interdisciplinary team of physicians, nurses, nutritionists, and mental health professionals to treat these complex disorders. Social workers play a vital role in this team. Social workers utilize a person in the environment framework that dually focuses on evidence-based individual and family treatments, as well as the environmental factors that exacerbate symptoms. On an interdisciplinary team, clinical social workers are poised to assess and provide evidence-based interventions to treat the mental health symptoms individuals with eating disorders and co-occurring disorders experience. Social workers are employed in a variety of settings that are points of service for people who struggle with eating disorders. For example, schools are charged with the care of students for the majority of their waking hours. School social workers are in the special position of having a long-term relationship with young children and adolescents, which allows them to identify changes in students that may indicate they are at risk of an eating disorder. School social workers play a vital role in promoting the physical, social, emotional, ethical, spiritual, academic development, and mental health of children and adolescents, and are often the first place where mental health concerns such as eating disorders are recognized and addressed. In addition, social workers are one of the largest providers of mental health services in New York State, providing treatment in hospitals, universities, home care, counseling centers, substance abuse centers, as well as inpatient and outpatient clinics. Mental health social workers are trained to provide a holistic assessment for each client that includes screening for co-occurring disorders. The National Association of Social Workers New York State Chapter and the National Association of Social Workers New York City Chapter commend Senator Carlucci for introducing legislation that addresses eating disorders. Legislation that promotes early intervention by screening children and adolescents for these disorders should include social workers as well as medical providers. As previously explained, social workers are positioned throughout the community and often have regular access to at-risk clients through positions in schools, hospitals, and treatment centers. As an approved provider for social work continuing education through the New York State Education Department, NASW is well positioned to be part of the team needed to treat these complex disorders. With funding, NASW could produce educational programming to reduce the risk, duration, and impact of eating disorders by providing social workers with the knowledge and resources to screen clients in their prospective places of employment. If given the opportunity, NASW is poised to develop and deliver free continuing education and professional development opportunities for all licensed social workers in the state. These offerings would include live webinars ensuring accessibility regardless of geographic barriers, as well as in-person conferences throughout the state, and the creation of a resource guide that would be distributed to all New York State licensed social workers. The curriculum would cover best practice treatment modalities such as cognitive behavioral therapy and familiarize social workers with the medical, emotional, and nutritional aspects of eating disorders as well as co-occurring disorders and present a framework to create district-wide awareness. Dedicated social workers who are educated and empowered have the potential to bring voice to an often silent, undertreated, and potentially fatal struggle. The proposed continuing education training would strengthen professional social workers who are on the front lines making assessments, linking individuals to services, providing clinical services, supporting families, and building partnerships with all service providers with whom an individual may be involved, often working across disciplines to meet the needs of clients diagnosed with an eating disorder. The National Association of Social Workers is willing to work with Chairman Carlucci and other committee members to assist with further legislative development, community roundtables, conducting research, or in other needed capacities. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Fletcher. And now, when we talk about continuing education for social workers, is there any component being offered for eating disorders or eating disorder screening?
So that is what we would be able to develop with the right, like if we were to have funding. So with social work, to explain the profession a little bit, we have a broad-based education. So we are trained to not only look at individuals and what they're suffering with, but also with the environment and the environmental things that play a part in that.
Right.
So with our education, once we graduate and we leave, we're continually getting education to become experts in our own areas.
Right.
So if you get a group of social workers together, you may have seven different social workers, and they will all have different levels of expertise.
Right. Okay.
So that's what we would look to developing is the expertise and to really develop social workers in key positions like schools and hospitals and treatment centers to be able to work specifically with people with eating disorders.
Excellent. We'll look forward to working with you, and I think this is a great suggestion. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
I appreciate your time.
Thank you. And next, we're going to hear from Chavez Turner, from the National Eating Disorders Association. Netta?
Good morning.
Good morning. Thanks for being here.
Thank you for having us. My name is Chavez Turner, and I'm here today on behalf of the National Eating Disorders Association to express our strong support for Bills S5869 and S5870, as well as proposed legislation related to curriculum on eating disorders in schools and the recognition of eating disorders by the Office of Mental Health. Thank you, Senator Carlucci, for hosting this hearing and for the opportunity to speak today. We're grateful for your leadership on these issues. I currently serve as the Chief Strategy and Policy Officer for the National Eating Disorders Association, the largest national organization supporting families and individuals affected by eating disorders. I'm also proud to be with you here today as a person who is in recovery from atypical anorexia and binge eating disorder. NEDA is headquartered in New York City and is the largest national organization supporting families and individuals affected by eating disorders, as I said. We operate a national helpline, host nearly 100 awareness walks across the country, including 6 across New York State, engage in advocacy on both the state and the federal level, and provide life-saving programs and resources to families and individuals in need of support. I applaud you and the New York State Standing Committee on Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities for your consideration of these important initiatives that could lead to increased early intervention and prevention of eating disorders in New York State. In the United States, as you mentioned, 20 million women and 10 million men will suffer from a clinically significant eating disorder at some time in their life, including anorexia, bulimia, binge eating disorder, and others. Eating disorders are real, complex, and devastating conditions that can have serious consequences for health, productivity, and relationships. They are not a fad, phase, or lifestyle choice. Eating disorders are serious, potentially life-threatening conditions. In fact, eating disorders have the second highest mortality rate of any mental illness immediately after opioid addiction disorder. Yet due to the lack of awareness and education, and frankly, many untrue myths about why eating disorders manifest and who gets them, many people do not receive the treatment they desperately need. It is often the case that these serious mental health disorders are not recognized or diagnosed until the physical health of an individual is compromised, at which point the damage may be irreversible. But the good news is that eating disorders are treatable, and early recognition may prevent the development of eating disorders and subsequent chronic physical and mental health conditions. NEDA views the initiatives proposed by Senator Carlucci as important steps towards the prevention and early intervention of eating disorders in the state of New York. We support S5869, which establishes the New York State Joint Eating Disorder Awareness Campaign and the New York State Joint Eating Disorder Awareness Campaign Fund to elevate awareness about eating disorders throughout the state. NEDA currently operates a National Eating Disorders Awareness Week campaign at the end of February each year, and we believe this bill will only serve to enhance and deepen the conversation and awareness statewide. We also support S5870, which requires the establishment of best practice protocols for screening of children for eating disorders by pediatric primary care providers. These protocols would incorporate standards and guidelines established by the American Academy of Pediatrics. Studies have demonstrated a link between early intervention and better treatment outcomes. The Academy of Pediatrics has recommended that screening questions about eating patterns and body image be asked of all preteens and adolescents to detect the onset of eating disorders. Treatment of full syndrome eating disorders costs over $30,000 a month. This figure does not include the cost of treating the secondary health conditions resulting from these disorders, which can often necessitate management over the lifespan if not addressed early. By preventing the development of full syndrome disorders and the chronic health problems they cause, early detection and intervention can save lives. Lastly, NIDA is very interested in supporting health promotion in schools to enhance a child's well-being. This being said, it is critical that the focus of curriculum in schools be on prevention that is age-appropriate and is not explicit about eating disorders behaviors, so as not to facilitate an idea that a child might not otherwise have had. Additionally, in order to carry through this type of health promotion effort, we advise that teachers and administrators be well-trained in curriculum and educated about the effects of diet culture, weight stigma, and body bullying, and other sociocultural factors that play a part in disordered relationships with body, food, and exercise. This will be important in creating an environment in which children can benefit from the curriculum. So thank you once again, Senator Carlucci, for your support of the eating disorders community and your leadership on these issues.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I just had a question. Now, you mentioned the $30,000 a month mm-hmm. figure, and could you tell us what goes into that, where that comes from?
That is typically a multidisciplinary approach to eating disorders, and it is typically that number is affiliated with the highest level of care in a residential program. Mm-hmm. So these are typically privately owned programs. Mm-hmm. That I'm not necessarily talking about academic mm-hmm. Programs in okay. hospitals. And so, you know, this is an area where there are a full range of services. Mm-hmm. Some are evidence-based, some are not. That's an entirely different issue. But they typically include psychiatric care, dietetic care, working with a therapist, and then all kinds of different therapies that may be utilized, you know, anywhere from, you know, yoga type activities mm-hmm. to, you know, equine therapy. There's
sure.
a whole host.
Now, we, a couple years back, we worked to define eating disorders so we could get insurance to cover it.
Yes.
We hear these nightmare stories. Could you tell me a little bit about that, your experience through NIDA? Has that turned around in New York? Is it better? Are people, once they are diagnosed, getting the treatment, and is insurance covering it?
I think that remains to be seen, and okay. I know some of my colleagues that are going to testify later this afternoon who are on the ground mm-hmm. doing this work can probably speak better to that. But this is something that has recently evolved mm-hmm. In terms of identifying that every eating disorder within the DSM would be covered here in mm-hmm. the state of New York. So I'll let my colleagues speak a bit more to that, but my impression at this point is that that coverage is getting better, but we're not there yet. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much
thank
for your
you.
Testimony. Thank you. I look forward to working with you on these issues.
You
thank you. And next we have Dr. Susan Horder from the Rockland County Department of Mental Health. Thank you, Dr. Horder. Nice
thank
to see you.
Thank you for having me. I'm Dr. Susan Horder. I'm the medical director for the Rockland County Department of Mental Health. I'm a child and adolescent psychiatrist by training. I'm also the Children's Local Governing Unit representative for mental health services in Rockland. And I don't have a written statement, so I'm hoping we can have a bit of a conversation. And I'd like to talk about systems issues as they relate to eating disorders. And I think eating disorders uniquely bring to light some of the concerns about regulatory and parity issues that are occurring across children's mental health. And I think it especially highlights the differences that are developing for families who have commercial insurance versus families who are not commercially insured but rather have Medicaid services. Mm-hmm. And as you know, a large percentage of Rockland residents are commercially insured, as are Westchester residents. So this is a really salient issue for residents in this area. So the first thing aside from that I'd like to say is any efforts towards moving towards integrated licensing would be key. So whether that's in this case having either primary care within a mental health services clinic or co-locating a mental health provider within a primary care office. Mm. Those are really essential to reducing stigma, normalizing treatment, and improving access. Mm. So I think that's a really important step as well. The larger issue is that with mental health services, commercial insurance pays less than half of what Medicaid reimburses. Mm. So what we find across our children's system of care is that it's very difficult to find providers who can afford to participate with commercial insurance. So if you're a commercially insured family, it's actually more difficult to find a provider than if you have Medicaid, which is, I think, counterintuitive and can be surprising to people. So
And as bad as private insurance, how is Medicaid?
Medicaid, for mental health services, it's actually the opposite of what we find in physical health care, where Medicaid pays less and commercial insurance pays is a better rate. Mm-hmm. In mental health services, commercial insurers generally, on average, reimburse less than half the rate of Medicaid. So what we find is that providers cannot afford to keep the doors open.
So is Medicaid, though, is it reimbursing enough?
It's better. I don't think anyone makes a lot of money in outpatient mental health care.
Right.
But what we see is that with enough of a Medicaid population, places can stay
open. There's still a big gap.
Right. Okay. There's a gap, but there's a huge gap. So it's very, very difficult to find a provider who accepts your commercial insurance if you're a family with a child with an eating disorder. And that's very concerning. So we have that. And then the other issue we have is that we have this really wonderful expanding system for children with Medicaid. And, we know that eating disorders also affect children with Medicaid. So that's excellent. But I think what we have is we don't have the same system of care developing for commercially insured children. So historically, we've had an alternate pathway for children who are commercially insured to access some community-based services. So there's something called home and community-based services, where if your child's needs are great enough, they waive the income requirement for Medicaid, and the child and the family, or the child actually gets waived into Medicaid services, which really provides an entire array of services that otherwise would not be accessible, very intensive, with the intention to keep children in the home and out of hospitals, which is key.
Dr. Horder, so would you recommend maybe a program where if it's an eating disorder that we get that waiver, an easier process?
Yes, and then I think for the larger children's system of care, and again, eating disorders really highlight this because of the high mortality rate. Mm-hmm. So I think you have two things going on which make it difficult to find a commercial, find a provider for commercially insured youth, which is that people are less likely to participate because of the low reimbursement rates and also because of the high mortality rate. So I think it's a higher risk for providers. And so it's important that the integrated services become streamlined, like the regulatory burdens and the billing burdens, so that we can have a good, effective, evidence-based, multidisciplinary treatment team who's operating either out of a primary care clinic or having primary care integrated into a mental health clinic. So the other thing that the state did, which is wonderful for Medicaid, for youth with Medicaid, is they came up with an entire service array of six services, four of which have been implemented so far, and the fifth and sixth will implement in January. And the intention behind these services is to get children identified earlier with mental health issues, or in this case, eating disorders, and to get services to them in the community, and also to get them to them sooner, right? So that we identify them sooner and we get them treatment sooner. So what's important to note about this service array, which is called Child and Family Treatment Services and Supports, is that we do not have an alternate pathway to access these services for non-Medicaid children. So as wonderful as they are, what it's contributing to is that we're having a two-tier or kind of a fractured children's system of care when it comes to mental health, because we don't have even services for everybody across the board, regardless of payer. So I think these things are really affecting all youth, and also affecting youth with eating disorders. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Thank you so much. I look forward to working with you on this. This is very specific and exactly what we were looking for.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Dr. Horder.
Thank you. And next we're gonna hear from Evelyn.
Evelyn can't be here.
Okay. Skip it, okay. She's here. Okay, well, we're ready. Evelyn, Dr. Evelyn Ida?
Atiyah.
Dr. Evelyn Atiyah. New York State Conference of Care Centers for Eating Disorders. Thank you for joining us.
Which chair is best, this one?
Yeah, perfect, right there in the middle.
Wonderful.
Hi, and thank you. Good morning to you, morning. Chairman Carlucci. My name is Dr. Evelyn Attia. I'm the director of the Metro New York Comprehensive Care Center for Eating Disorders, not Conference on Eating Disorders, just to clarify.
Thank
and
you.
That's no problem. That's shorthand called Metro CCCED. I'm also a professor of clinical psychiatry at New York Presbyterian Hospital, the Hospital of Columbia University, and Weill Cornell's medical centers. Thank you for the opportunity to testify about eating disorders, treatment, and recovery this morning. Eating disorders, including anorexia nervosa, bulimia nervosa, binge eating disorder, and avoidant restrictive food intake disorder, also called ARFID, are serious psychiatric illnesses associated with significant medical and psychiatric morbidity or illness and high rates of mortality, as you've heard earlier today. It's estimated that there are currently more than 18,000 New Yorkers living with anorexia nervosa or bulimia nervosa, and a higher number living with binge eating disorder. Proper diagnosis is often missed because many health professionals receive little to no education on this. The illnesses are rare enough that some clinicians don't see them during their training, and patients are reluctant to discuss these symptoms with their clinicians because they're ashamed or they're afraid of seeking treatment. Once eating disorders are identified, treatment is often hard to navigate, and you heard a little bit about that from Dr. Horder just before. The reasons for the difficulty in navigating treatment include the fact that eating disorders commonly require both medical and behavioral health components of care, and some health systems and health insurance companies view these elements separately, making it difficult to arrange truly comprehensive care. Also, there are significant regional differences for treatment options for eating disorders. Some of the difficulties you just heard from Dr. Horder are a little bit different in other counties, and it may be the children insured by Medicaid who are the ones having a tough time finding specialized services, outpatient services, in their regions. Additionally, some health insurance plans often limit treatment by cutting short some interventions or including coverage for some types of treatment in certain settings and not others. While treatment for eating disorders can be highly effective with full recovery possible for most affected individuals, delays in case identification and referral to evidence-based care contribute to longer-term illness with disability and the development of, frankly, chronic cases in some. For more than a decade, the Metro CCCED, based in New York City at New York Presbyterian Hospital, New York State Psychiatric Institute, the Northeast Center, based at Albany Medical Center, and the Western CCCED, based in Rochester at the University of Rochester Medical Center, have been diligently working together and partnering with patients, families, and schools to create a cost-effective, coordinated, and integrated model of care and an infrastructure across the state. New York State established these programs in 2007 in an effort to keep residents in the state for their treatment whenever possible and to avoid the creation of redundant services in order to maintain a high level of quality at the right cost. For example, there's only one specialized inpatient psychiatric unit for eating disorders in all of New York State. That's at New York Pres. There are just two adolescent inpatient centers, one on Long Island and one in Rochester, for example. These programs have also been able to fill gaps and develop new services using program funds to launch new initiatives, including the recent setup of the only partial hospital program, day treatment program specifically for eating disorders, that actually accepts publicly insured individuals, and that's at New York Presbyterian Hospital. The centers also support care coordination components that aren't reimbursable by health insurance, such as case management geared at keeping people in their homes and not using emergency or high-intensity treatments. These programs are also the only ones that actually have, somewhere amidst all their parts, a full continuum of care specifically targeting individuals with eating disorders covered by Medicaid or Medicare. And really, in the grand scheme of things, that's a rare set of services. Importantly, these programs are committed to teaching providers, primary care, mental health care, dietitians, and other school personnel about eating disorders. They've created an online learning collaborative called Project Echo, in which clinicians can participate, receive CME credit, and hear about relevant topics, discuss case management from all parts of the state. Coincidentally, I just came back along with a bunch of colleagues from a CCCED-sponsored full-day statewide conference in Syracuse, New York, where 250 clinicians came and really were able to obtain training that they couldn't get another way. These programs are thankful for support received from the legislature and from New York State. However, the way these programs are funded places them at risk each year of being closed down, since the dedicated portion of the budget is very small. It's $39,000 per center for each of these centers. The bulk of the funding, and we have been fortunate enough to get much more than that amount in the last few years, it's through yearly appropriations by the legislature, and the level of funding definitely fluctuates. So it makes it difficult to plan each year when we're not certain whether we're going to have the funds to continue to operate the programs. Having an appropriate and consistent level of funding each year will allow the CCCEDs to continue to provide high-quality coordinated care for patients with eating disorders across the care continuum and foster relapse prevention and sustained recovery in the community. It's my hope that members of the New York State Senate and Assembly will seek to have the necessary program funds baselined in the upcoming state budget, and that'll allow us to focus the efforts on improving care, reducing the burden of disease for New Yorkers affected with these very challenging conditions. So I thank you again for the opportunity to testify, and I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Great. Well, thank you so much for testifying. Just a couple quick questions.
Sure.
So the Project ECHO, who do you see participating in that program?
So there are clinicians in all parts of the state. There actually are two Project ECHO collaboratives, one coming out of the University of Rochester and one at Albany Med. And essentially there's a schedule, there's a website, and one of the great things that happened at that Syracuse conference is new clinicians learned of this option, mm-hmm. and they can dial in. It's a weekly commitment
and
for a set period of time.
What type of clinicians are they?
All different clinicians,
okay.
and we wind up with some primary care folks, primary care and school personnel.
Yeah, I think okay.
Those are
and it's because the school encouraged them to go?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know. I think word of mouth is helping us get mm-hmm. the word out that this is an available resource for clinicians within, and actually because of the internet, there's some folks outside of the state who are trying to access the service as well.
Okay. And given your close affiliation with the primary care physicians, and we have this legislation S5870, which relates to the screening of children with eating disorders. Is that something that you think, have you been able to review the legislation? Do you think it's practical? What do you think the response would be to the physicians that you work with?
I think that having more training opportunities for primary care clinicians can really make a tremendous difference in individuals' awareness when they meet with one of these patients, knowing how to ask, what to ask, all of the rest. What's sometimes complicated is having one more educational requirement, mm-hmm. and so we've tried to work around that by making more material available and then proliferating our information about it and hoping that even without the requirement, we've got more folks mm-hmm. wanting to access that that education. I would say that online education is really where it's at. Mm-hmm. We're currently doing that for medical students and creating an online course, trying to connect it with the Center for Practice Innovations at the New York State Psychiatric Institute, which is a hub of educational materials for clinicians of a variety of sorts all around the state, trying to create evidence-based training opportunities and then getting the word out that people can develop continuing education credit. The education is free, mm-hmm. And we're really hoping that, you know, in this kind of an area where there really is a gap in education, we're going to get folks to sign on. Mm-hmm. But a piece of regulation or legislation, it's not going to hurt if we can get it through. The idea that these clinicians really have to learn about this important area is only value added.
And the Project ECHO, that counts as continuing education
yes,
for our doctors?
Yes, they receive CME credit
okay.
For participating.
Right. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for your testimony.
You're welcome. Thanks.
Look forward to working with you. Thank you. And next we're going to hear from Dr. Richard Crepe. Oh, Dr. Richard Crepe from the Golisano Children's Hospital, University of Rochester Medical Center.
Thank you, Senator Carlucci. As an adolescent medicine specialist, my patients all call me Dr. Creepy, so
okay.
I'm used to that. So.
Okay.
But it is pronounced Creepy.
Okay.
Thank you, Senator Carlucci,
thank you.
For convening this public hearing with the goal of, quote, determining the best approaches to New York State government can take to help those with eating disorders receive the timely medical treatment they need to fully recover. Thank you also for introducing two Senate bills, one to establish an eating disorder awareness campaign and campaign fund in New York, and another for the State Commissioner of Health to establish best practice protocols for early screening of children with children for eating disorders by pediatric care providers, and also, as well as proposing legislation to establish a standardized health class curriculum on eating disorders in schools. These will be important elements in a statewide public health strategy to address the potentially devastating, at times life-threatening complications of eating disorders by focusing on early recognition and treatment. To provide context from my perspective, I completed medical school, pediatric resident, and chief resident training in Philadelphia before completing my specialty training in adolescent medicine at the University of Rochester Medical Center in 1981 and remained there as an active faculty member to this day. I was drawn to Rochester because at the time it was the home of three innovations in medicine, the biopsychosocial approach to illness, as well as concepts of community pediatrics and behavioral pediatrics. And the confluence of these innovations have shaped my career over the past 40 years. As a pediatric-based academic clinician, I've been involved in establishing the Child and Adolescent Eating Disorder Program in the Department of Pediatrics at the University of Rochester Medical Center in 1984, directing the federally funded Leadership Education and Adolescent Health Interdisciplinary Training Program at the University of Rochester Medical Center from 1997 to 2012. In serving as the medical director of the Western New York Comprehensive Care Center for Eating Disorders, funded by New York State Department of Health since its inception in 2005, and also in serving as the only pediatrician and adolescent medicine specialist on the eating disorder work group, resulting in the publication of the DSM-5 American Psychiatric Statistical Manual in 2013. I'm proud to say I was serving with Dr. Atiyah on that. So to address the goal of this public hearing, I'll make three points regarding patients who develop an eating disorder between 10 and 20 years of age, focusing on two conditions, restrictive anorexia nervosa and avoidant restrictive food intake disorder, ARFID, both of which emerge almost exclusively in the second decade of life and can have serious medical complications from inadequate nutrition relative to the needs of children's developing brain and body. First, health outcomes are improved when affected individuals receive early diagnosis and treatment in primary care settings. Second, patterns of disordered eating behaviors related to restrictive anorexia nervosa and ARFID are best identified early at the subclinical level before they reach the full threshold diagnostic criteria and become habits that are resistant to change. Third, based on our experience in the Western New York region CCCED over the past 14 years, we have identified critically helpful supportive services provided by individuals who have personally experienced recovery from an eating disorder that build on professional encounters in outpatient and inpatient clinical settings by physicians, nurses, dietitians, social workers, and other mental health providers. For primary care, outcome studies in the adolescent medicine literature, including reports from our group, show that the longer an eating disorder persists prior to initiating effective treatment, all else being equal, the poorer the outcome. Once eating disorder habits are established, especially if they result in dysfunctional responses in the family that can impair or preclude family-based therapy. Our experience in Rochester suggests that patients who are diagnosed in the primary care setting and then referred early for treatment in adolescent medicine for more definitive treatment in collaboration with the patient's primary care provider tend to have a better outcome than those whose illness is established and entrenched. Responding to the challenge of addressing the extremes of eating problems in primary care, that is morbid obesity and restrictive anorexia nervosa, the American Academy of Pediatrics published a clinical report guiding primary care physicians titled Preventing Obesity and Eating Disorders in Adolescents as a complement to an earlier guidance that was focused on the management of eating disorders in primary care. This report notes that obesity and eating disorders are both prevalent in adolescents and that there are concerns that obesity prevention efforts may lead to the development of an eating disorder. Most adolescents who develop an eating disorder did not have obesity previously, but some teenagers, in an attempt to lose weight, may develop an eating disorder. This clinical report addresses the potential interaction between obesity prevention and eating disorders in teenagers and provides a pediatrician with evidence-informed tools to identify behaviors that predispose to both obesity and eating disorders and provides guidance about obesity and eating disorder prevention messages. The focus should be on healthy lifestyle rather than on weight. Evidence suggests that obesity prevention and treatment, if conducted correctly, do not predispose to eating disorders. And so this report includes six recommendations that I'll include in the written recommendations. I'll just highlight the points of number one is to discourage dieting, skipping of meals, or the use of diet pills, but instead focus on healthy living and healthy habits rather than on weight, talking about positive body image among adults. Also, the importance of family meals. The data are clear that individuals who have family meals, eating disorders are less likely to occur. Also, to carefully monitor weight loss in an adolescent who needs to lose weight to ensure that the adolescent does not develop medical complications. Next, moving to subclinical diagnosis. In a dramatic departure from the DSM-4, the DSM-5 was designed to identify patients earlier in the course of illness, and with respect to restrictive anorexia nervosa, artificial low weight thresholds were eliminated, although some providers still place significant reliance on weight to determine the degree of illness. In addition, ARFID was added as a, quotes, new, end quotes, eating disorder because of its associated morbidity and scientific data to support its existence. A major goal of DSM-5 was to enable clinicians to identify patients early in the course of an evolving illness rather than holding off until arbitrary criteria were met. When I first arrived in Rochester in 1979, I recall not being able to diagnose a patient with restrictive anorexia nervosa because, despite all other features characteristic of the illness, her weight had not yet fallen to 25% below her, quotes, ideal body weight required for definitive diagnosis and research protocols at the time. Although early screening of children for eating disorders by primary care providers may identify patients early in the course of illness, a basic principle of screening is to link patients with a, quote, positive, end quote, screen to an intervention within the primary care setting. That is, once a young patient is recognized as having eating disorder habits that could progress to more serious illness, the first step would not be to refer the patient to an eating disorder program, but to institute changes within the child's environment at home, at school, and in the community to return to more healthy behavior patterns while also addressing possible underlying issues related to commonly associated anxiety and/or mood disturbance. We are fortunate to have a program funded by New York State Office of Mental Health called Project Teach that offers training in several different formats for primary care providers to support their ability to assess, treat, and manage mild to moderate mental health concerns in their clinical practices. This established and readily available statewide network linking pediatric mental health experts and primary care providers would present an ideal opportunity to address the needs of primary care providers who identify children and adolescents early in the course of illness before habits have become entrenched and difficult to change, to institute changes using principles of family-based treatment with respect to eating, and also to suggest non-pharmacologic interventions such as mindfulness to address underlying emotional vulnerabilities. Primary care providers need to realize that they can have an important role in the treatment of restrictive anorexia nervosa. In an article by two former presidents of the American Academy for Eating Disorders, psychiatrist Michael Strober and psychologist Craig Johnson wrote an article regarding the complexity of this condition, obliquely emphasizing the role that primary care interventions can have, noting, and I'll just mention some of the things that one is anorexia nervosa is a brain disease. This explains why patients behave strangely and say illogical things. Their actions, perceptions, and utterances are irrational because their brain is. Another line was that the features once thought to be part of the psychological realm are really effects of its genetic underpinnings, having no unique significance of their own. Also, family turmoil should be viewed as only a byproduct of the frustration that the illness sows. Weight correction needs to take priority from these tensions to resolve. Things said by patients about their relationships, family ones included, should not be taken too seriously. Also, psychotherapy cannot and should not take place until the brain is mended by restoring weight. Finally, family-based behavioral therapy is the only acceptable method for treating young patients. And so I think that we can see that in these kind of settings, primary care providers have an important role in getting things going in the right direction. And I want to finish up talking about supportive services. Although family-based treatment delivered in the context of an intraprofessional team has the best evidence of effectiveness in the treatment of eating disorders in children and adolescents, what such teams often lack are stories of a, quote, lived experience of recovery from the perspective of a patient or a parent. Since February 1990, I facilitated a monthly support group meeting for parents and loved ones of an individual who has an eating disorder. At these meetings of the Rochester Eating Disorder Network, now also video conferenced with Buffalo and Syracuse, I've learned much about what helps and what hinders recovery from an eating disorder. More importantly, over the years, I've been able to share what I've learned in these sessions with patients and parents I've treated in clinical settings, as well as with professionals and educational lectures, workshops, and trainings. However, I am only parroting what I have heard from patients and parents, and adolescents often tell me, "You just don't understand," to which I acknowledge I do not have any firsthand experience with recovery. However, within the Western New York Comprehensive Care Center for Eating Disorders, we have two amazing individuals who are able to share their experiences. One, a patient underwent the full range of treatment intensity and settings in her recovery from a very ill adolescent to a now recovered young adult, and the other as a parent of a child who similarly went through the full range of treatment intensity and settings from a 12-year-old child to a now young adult who has made remarkable strides in recovery. These individuals, a, quotes, peer mentor for patients, and a, quotes, parent mentor for parents of an affected child, have played important roles in supporting treatment. Our peer mentor serves as a resource and sounding board, offering support and information to help navigate recovery. She shares her personal experience and support in identifying challenges, strengths, and needs in order to move ahead. She specifically works with the professional team to help them seek treatment, especially those who resist treatment to maybe surrender to recommended level of care. She has an incredible number of opportunities to interact with patients in ways that are very non-threatening. And I just wanted to include some of the comments that patients have made regarding this young woman. I just wanted to take a minute to thank you for all you've done for me. You've been my greatest support, inspiration, and friend. You've saved my life, and words can't express how thankful I am for that. Another, thank you so much for your support and encouragement. I keep a list of everything you say and refer to it when I'm struggling. I completed dinner and late night snack, and I've been completing 100% since we met. Thank you so much. Seriously, I'm so grateful for you. Also, I cannot tell you how much of your support has done and helped me. You are such an inspiration. And this is, I think, a very important concept. You got me to inpatient. This was a person who was resisting inpatient treatment, but having talked to this patient peer mentor, was able to get to inpatient treatment and succeed. Our parent peer mentor presented testimony at a Senate public health hearing on eating disorders back in 2011, and she has provided critical support to parents in outpatient clinical encounters, inpatient family sessions, and through in-person contact by phone or in the community ever since. In her instrumental role in the Western New York Comprehensive Care Center for Eating Disorders, she has expanded the Rochester Eating Disorder Network meetings to include weekly educational support groups, has conducted half-day parent workshops addressing common daily conflicts that arise in the context of having a daughter or a son with an eating disorder. Over the years, I've heard comments similar to those above regarding the value of having input from someone who has, quotes, been there, done that, with respect to parenting a child, adolescent, or a young adult son or daughter with an eating disorder. Often when I've had a scheduled clinic patient visit with a patient and parent, the parent would describe her multiple conversations over the phone that she had already had with the parent peer mentor and be very proud of having been able to do what she needed to do in order to avert a crisis and continue to move towards recovery. What was especially interesting is how often the patient would tell me in private, I don't know what Michelle said to my dad, but it really helped him get off my back, and he's helping me rather than criticizing me and making me feel worse. So it's clear that having these individuals providing supportive services to patients and parents within the context of the Western New York Comprehensive Care Center for Eating Disorders is extremely helpful. However, increased funding is needed in New York State to support expansion of these kinds of services, which I believe would likely result in cost savings related to treatment of these very complex conditions. Given the time limits, I will end, but have many ideas about how else to address the goals of this public hearing. I would be happy to answer any questions that you may have that these comments may have sparked. Again, thank you for the opportunity to speak on behalf of our patients and parents.
Well, thank you, Dr. Crapy, and I do have a few questions and look forward. We probably won't be able to get to them all right now, but please do send over to me some more of the suggestions. And at the end of your testimony, you're talking about increased resources. And are you referring to sponsor peer mentor programs? Is that what you're referring to?
I think that the evidence is really clear that mm-hmm. these individuals can make a real impact that professionals just don't have the same
right.
credibility.
Do you have any idea how many peer mentor groups there are in New York State? How frequent these groups meet?
I'm not aware of any.
Okay.
Dr. Atiyah and her group might be aware.
Yeah, maybe some others today could testify.
No, but I don't know.
And you mentioned halfway through you were talking about 6 recommendations.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, I kind of missed briefly. Can you go through the 6 or is it the long?
Yeah, let me just end this. Excuse me.
They want to add their voice.
So again, discourage dieting, skipping of meals.
Okay.
Providing
one.
A positive body image.
Is that 2?
That's 2.
Okay.
Number 3 is family meals. Number 3 is encouraging families to not talk about weight, but rather talk about healthy eating and being active to stay healthy.
Mm-hmm.
Also to inquire about a history of mistreatment or bullying in overweight or obese teenagers, and then carefully monitor weight loss. So those are the 6 elements.
You know, Dr. Crapy, I was reading an article, I think it came out about a month ago in The Atlantic, about it was a pretty in-depth article, but it was referring to a case of a young child who had developed an eating disorder and also obsessive compulsive disorder. And it also talked about the link to suicide as well. And we had a hearing a few months ago on suicide prevention, and we see the relationship here. But this this article went into great detail about strep, having strep throat, and the bacterial infection, and how they're seeing a correlation between this bacterial infection and eating disorders. Right. And OCD. Could you speak to that? Do you have any experience with that?
That is something called PANDAS. And I think it is a thing with which is still debated.
It seemed it was pretty new.
Well, it's not just new, but there's no doubt that the streptococcal infection can cause an immune response that has a number of different mental health kinds of issues. And I think that's kind of the point, is that somehow that triggers something that then triggers an obsessive compulsive.
Is this
response.
Something that we, the medical community, is looking out for, particularly when we're dealing with mental illness, when we're dealing with eating disorders, that this is something that we should, you know, I as a child, I still do occasionally get strep throat, but, and it probably happens frequently, and there's no ramifications, but has it risen to the level where we should be concerned and we should be asking certain questions after someone has a bacterial infection like that?
I think it's worth asking. I think what's still not established is the cause-effect relationship. Just because something happens after something doesn't mean it was caused by something.
Right.
That's all.
And have you had experience with that in the 40 years
I've had,
you've been?
I have two patients who've been working on with that area. And we, the parents were very, you know, supportive of working on both the treating the strep infection, but also dealing with the underlying issues in family-based therapy. So.
Okay, great. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Forward to working with you on all these issues. Thank you, Dr. Crapy. And she wants to go right now? Okay, can I just see it? Okay, and we have from the West Hudson Psychiatric Society, Manawara Begum. Yes, please, are you ready to testify? Great, okay, no problem. Thank you. Good to see you. Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Begum. Here, sit right in the middle. Thank you.
Hi. Thank you, Senator Carlucci, for inviting me to this important public hearing. Like any other mental illness, eating disorder is something very important that we have to be aware of, that it is a mental illness, and we have to educate public about it. I made a very small summary. I want to say at the outset that I'm not an expert in eating disorder. I'm an adult psychiatrist, but I work in Summit School, where I treat adolescents, and I did see several adolescents with a different type of eating disorder, you know, restrictive type, bulimia, and I did send a couple of them to Renfrew Institute, which is a institute treating eating disorder. So as probably other speakers already spoke, eating disorders usually start in the late adolescence or early adulthood. It can affect 0.9 to 2% of young women. And there are several types of eating disorder. PICA, which is persistent eating of non-food. Regurgitated food may be rechewed or spit out. Avoidant restrictive food intake disorder, which is lack of interest in eating or food avoidance leading to significant weight loss. Bulimia nervosa, recurrent episodes of binge eating, eating in a discrete period of time, a sense of lack of control over eating during the episode, which is very important, lack of control. Binge eating disorder, recurrent episode of binge eating, eating much more rapidly than normal, eating large amount, and eating until feeling uncomfortable. This one can be more common in male or older adults. And then the anorexia nervosa, which is restriction of energy intake, causing marked weight loss in the context of age, sex, developmental trajectory, and physical health. Intense fear of gaining weight or becoming fat. Disturbance in the experience of body shape or body image, which is the hallmark of this diagnosis. And anorexia nervosa has two different types. One is restrictive type, another one is binge eating type. The restrictive type has weight loss is accomplished primarily through dieting, fasting, and or excessive exercise. Binge eating type, recurrent episode of binge eating or purging behavior by self-induced vomiting, misuse of laxatives, diuretics, and enemas. In terms of formulation of public health policy, even though the vast majority of female adolescents who diet, only 2 to 3% develop an eating disorder. This finding poses an interesting dilemma for public health policy. On the one hand, prevalence of obesity is increasing, which suggests that dietary interventions are important. But on the other hand, a small proportion of women may respond to dieting by developing an eating disorder. Education about healthy eating habits would seem important, particularly in adolescents, in an effort to stop the development of restrictive dieting. Comorbidity of anxiety disorder, depression, obsessive-compulsive disorder need to be acknowledged. As with most mental illness, the etiology is biopsychosocial. The interplay of combination of genetic, psychological, and social factors. In Western culture, thinness in young women is encouraged as a measure of beauty. Education, raising awareness about eating disorder as a mental health issue, reducing stigma, early intervention, creating special treatment programs targeted to the population, and access to a variety of psychiatric, behavioral, and medical treatment should be made available. Early diagnosis, treatment, and management would reduce suffering and mortality from eating disorder. Various treatments available are cognitive behavioral therapy, exposure therapy, relational cultural therapy, group therapy in a structured setting, nutritional medical assessment, and treatment of comorbid mental illness with psychotropic medication if needed.
Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And one thing, I should have asked this earlier, but for anyone, one of the things that I have had questions about is when we talk about, you know, the being selective and picky and the conversation about food and diet, we see an increase with children with food allergies. And I know my son has a food allergy, and so we're very picky and selective. And I worry about what type of, does that have any lasting impact in terms of an eating disorder? And I was wondering if anybody could speak to that in terms of if we see any correlation or anything like that.
I think, you know, if the allergy is diagnosed with the allergy specialist, you know, by doing the skin testing and all that, so that we know specifically which food your son is allergic to,
right,
then you just avoid that.
Yes.
But usually the allergists suggest, you know, you can reintroduce the food in
right.
the future.
Well, not necessarily the allergy component in that issue.
No,
yes,
I'm
we're well aware. The issue of just how you have to be very cognizant of what you're eating and fearful of foods
right.
and how that could have a lasting impact on our children and how that could relate to an eating disorder.
Well,
yeah. We'll maybe come back after. Oh, yeah, thank you.
If you want an additional piece, I mean, I can say that the illnesses
were talking. Do you want to come up to the mic real quick?
Sure.
Hi. Just to say
your
that.
Name again.
Sure, I'm Dr. Evelyn Atiyah again from New York City.
The illnesses we're talking about today are not new illnesses. They're
right.
old illnesses. But elements of the social context certainly affect who might be vulnerable, if they are indeed a person biologically vulnerable, to developing, to moving from restriction that makes some sense to restriction that really puts somebody at risk in the
right.
way that an eating disorder certainly includes. So we are seeing, just as some decades ago we might have seen in the context of certain fad diets that were popular then, that many of the individuals who developed formal eating disorders said it started when mm-hmm. that occurred.
Mm-hmm.
We
mm-hmm.
are seeing, as there's more awareness and actually more prevalence of allergies, we are seeing some individuals who will say it started when I became so afraid
mm.
when I'd go to school that maybe there'd be a nut or a
right.
gluten
a
or
a
something,
yeah.
and it's in that context. But it's not as though everybody mm-hmm. being asked to
right.
be careful with eating is vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
There probably is a biological vulnerability that a small number within our population has, and if exposed to that kind of risk experience,
yeah.
those are the individuals who we may worry about a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
So we still want those healthy eating messages and
right.
Stable eating messages and good monitoring so that kids have everything working for them.
Yeah, because I'm thinking that as we're talking about this and the conversations I've had over time, that I'm like, oh, wow, it's adding up to, wow, we're being very restrictive and fearful of these foods.
Right.
And it could have that correlation. I'm just thinking, first of all, as a parent, but
sure.
also as a senator, for best practices that we could implement.
Well, that awareness is an essential first step to
right.
making sure that your kid continues with healthy eating.
Right. Dr. Kripe,
thank you. I think from the American Academy of Pediatrics, there's a recognition that any time that there's heightened focus on nutrition, kids with diabetes, there's a thing called diabulimia, because when people have to be paying attention to their calories in and out, they just have a heightened sensitivity. So whether it's you're avoiding certain
right.
foods because
yeah.
there might be an allergic response, also the issue of one of the difficulties with having a person who is overweight and has medical complications of overweight and talking about weight reduction, a lot of times the issue is they go overboard with it. And so it comes down to an issue of balance. And I think anytime
yeah.
there's a heightened sensitivity of talking about and thinking about food, calories, et cetera, I think there's the vulnerability of triggering something if a person is biologically vulnerable to having an eating disorder. So it's very complex.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, thank you very much.
Well, I think, you know, family education is something also very important. As long as the family is aware that, you know, their child has certain kind of allergy and has to avoid that food, and they will be more, you know, watching over the child to see that the child does not start restricting other foods also.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, you know, education is most important of the public, the family, mm-hmm. the individual, and then getting the early treatment so that we can stop the progression. I think with any mental illness, you know, awareness, reducing the stigma, and getting to early treatment and access to treatment also
mm-hmm.
is very important. So I would say those are important issues.
Great. Well, Dr. Begum, thank you so much for your time and your testimony.
You.
Really appreciate it.
Okay,
thank
you're
you.
Welcome. Thank you for inviting me.
Great. And next we're going to hear from Hannah Zalvin. Hannah is a resident in Westchester County, and I got to know her, I guess, earlier this year or last year
mm-hmm.
at all. I'm not sure, when she came into my office and shared with me her story. And it's really, she did such a good job of being so eloquent and expressing it that I invited her up to our committee meeting in Albany, and she trekked all the way up to Albany at one of our committee meetings to share her story. And I'm just so grateful for getting to know you and for sharing your experience. So with that, Hannah Zalvin.
Hello, everyone. My name is Hannah Zalvin. I am 17 years old and a senior in high school. I am so glad that I have the opportunity to share my experience and to help support Senator Carlucci's efforts to bring legislation on eating disorder awareness and prevention that will affect schools, healthcare, and public awareness in New York State. I am recovering from a very long and difficult eating disorder. I was diagnosed as having avoidant restrictive food intake disorder, or ARFID, anorexia, and orthorexia 2 years ago, but my eating disorder began when I was just 7 years old. During those 8 years before I was diagnosed, nobody knew what was really going on with me. I was thin, but never emaciated, and my parents just thought I was a picky eater. I was bounced around from doctor to doctor with multiple problems. I had endoscopies and colonoscopies from a GI. I was treated by an endocrinologist for short stature. I went to ENTs for reflux, a nutritionist for my poor eating habits, and a psychologist for anxiety. It is my opinion that this prolonged diagnosis was from a lack of knowledge and awareness of eating disorders, as well as the fact that I didn't portray a typical anorexic. I was never screened by any of the doctors for an eating disorder during these 8 years. I had had health class in middle school and high school, where I found the curriculum to be very brief and geared towards body type, healthy eating, and healthy living, promoting eating green and exercising for health. But I never learned about the lesser known eating disorders like the ones I had, such as ARFID and orthorexia. I am here today to give my support for Senator Carlucci's two legislative bills, S-5869 and S-5870, as well as his proposed legislation on setting up a standard curriculum in public schools on eating disorders and highlighting eating disorders as a mental health issue. After finishing my eating disorder treatment, I began to do research on eating disorders, especially the lesser-known diagnoses. Through my research, I discovered that eating disorders were so prevalent that 1 out of every 8 people have an eating disorder, translating to over 500,000 children in New York State suffering with some type of eating disorder, yet only 50,000 of them will get treatment. Eating disorders are often associated with other mental health disorders, such as depression and anxiety, with there being a much higher risk of suicide among those who have an eating disorders compared to those who don't. I also discovered the many myths and stereotypes regarding this ailment that lead to misdiagnosing or prolonging treatment and recovery. Some of these myths include the belief that anorexics have to be emaciated, young children don't have eating disorders, and eating disorders are a choice. In fact, eating disorders cuts across all races, ages, socioeconomic classes, and gender. After this research, I created and developed an eating disorder awareness and advocacy campaign. My approach was three-pronged, targeting the adults that are most in contact with children and adolescents. My focus is on educating doctors, specifically pediatricians, promoting a standardized curriculum for eating disorders in public schools, and promoting awareness. For my healthcare advocacy, I met with Senator Carlucci last spring and explained to him my idea that every child should be screened annually for eating disorders, not only those who are suspected of having one. My thought is to have an annual screen where pediatricians ask a few questions which might help illuminate if there might be a problem, so a proper referral can be made. Much like how children are screened for sight and hearing, my hope is that there could be an attestation box on the annual school required physical. Senator Carlucci's bill, S-5870, relates to the screening of eating disorders, and I fully support this bill. I have also presented to pediatricians at Grand Rounds, where I helped to raise awareness of the prevalence of eating disorders and to promote for screening of all patients. I received positive feedback that this is an important issue to address. For the educational advocacy, I met with Commissioner Orth and Victoria Shaw from the Westchester Department of Community Mental Health. We are collaborating with Northern and Southern BOCES to implement a standardized curriculum in public schools, as well as to raise sensitivity and awareness by the school administration and staff. My hope is to have a standardized curriculum that will include all of the eating disorders, especially the lesser known ones, and that it would be taught in a way that is sensitive to vulnerable students in a non-triggering language. For example, my high school health class taught us how to measure our waist size, and we were told to eat healthily. As someone suffering from orthorexia, eating healthily almost killed me. For the awareness part of my advocacy, I fully support Senator Carlucci's bill, S-5869, which supports a New York State-funded eating disorder awareness campaign. If I had been aware of the lesser-known diagnoses, such as ARFID and orthorexia, I wouldn't have been shuffled around from doctor to doctor. I have presented my experience and advocacy campaign to local and state legislators, including members of the Committee on Mental Health in Albany, the Board of Legislators in Westchester County, the Environment and Health Committee of Westchester County, and the Family Task Force. Eating disorders are a very private disease. Even though I lived amongst many caring and devoting people, my friends, family, and doctors, my eating disorder still evaded everyone. As children and teens, we are surrounded by adults, but we will remain unseen and undiagnosed if the adults don't have the information to help us. Today is a very important day for me. My goals align with Senator Carlucci's policy efforts, which is to arm the caring and concerned adults who are on the front lines every day with children with information to prevent prolonged suffering and unnecessary medical testing. Lucky for me, I finally did get the diagnosis. I have been through an inpatient hospital unit, a residential treatment center, a partial hospitalization program, an intense outpatient program, and I am currently an outpatient. I am now healthy, and just like most other kids my age, I am stressed about applying to colleges and trying to avoid senioritis. However, I am committed to this cause to see that these important and life-saving bills are passed into law. Thank you.
Great. Well, Hannah, thank you so much, and I'm just so grateful to you. Yes. Because as we talked about earlier today, that experience and sharing that experience is just one of the greatest things that we can do. So I'm so grateful to you for documenting your experience and sharing it. And in your experience, what do you think? How was your eating disorder eventually discovered? As you talked about, it took 7 years or 8 years before it was diagnosed.
Yeah. So I started growth hormone treatment when I was really young because I was very short for my age. Mm-hmm. And after many years of the treatment and not seeing much growth, my endocrinologist referred me to an adolescent medicine specialist where I was then diagnosed with the eating disorder.
Wow. And like you said, that you had been to so many different doctors and specialists, and they were doing all types of medical tests and treatments, mm-hmm. But never were you screened for an eating disorder. And, you know, looking back, like 2020 hindsight, it seems so obvious, right? That obviously in this room today and what we're talking about. But I think one of the things that you highlight about 90% of the children in New York State that have an eating disorder will go undiagnosed. Mm-hmm. And the problems and complications that come from that are intense. And immense. And so I look forward to working with you on this. Any feedback that you have from, I know you've been sitting here today, and any insight that you have from what you've heard so far today, in addition to your testimony?
I think many of the issues that were raised were very important and will help so many people if these ideas are followed through. Reflecting on like allergies, I think that's a very important aspect as well. As it, when I was only 2 or 3 years old, I had an allergic reaction to lentils, which I then developed a fear of lentils and eating certain foods. So I think aspects that are not immediately looked at, I think it's important to look at all the aspects, as so many things that people don't think will affect eating disorders actually have been.
Mm-hmm. So and like you mentioned, you talked about the healthy eating aspect and how good intentions, right? And it was also related to that article that I was reading about that young, it was a young man who in school had learned, taken the course, the health class, and it had that adverse effect where he started to be very concerned about what he was consuming and then the strep throat and all that, and it added to it. And so that's a big eye-opener, I think, for me in terms of how we have to make sure that we're not having an adverse effect in fighting obesity, because that's on everyone's mind in terms of the obesity epidemic we hear, but how it could have a real adverse effect. Mm-hmm. So I think you're exactly right, that if we have age-appropriate content or a curriculum for our children, how big of an impact that could be, and then also for the teachers, that they understand what to look for. I think about that as a parent, about how with these issues, we don't often think of at such a young age. Mm-hmm. We think of, okay, you know, you're on social media or something like that, the body image and all that, but at such a young age that this can happen.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm so grateful for you for the work that you've done and look forward to working with you to see those two bills, but many more that we look to draft before the end of the year to make sure we get these bills passed this year in Albany. Yeah. So thank you so much, Hannah.
Thank you.
Thank you. And next we'll hear from Dr. Ravi from the Academy of Family Physicians. Thank you.
Sure. Chairman Carlucci, thank you so much for conducting these public hearings on this important topic and for allowing me the opportunity to present my perspective today. My name is Dr. Anita Ravi. I'm a board member of the New York State Academy of Family Physicians, which represents nearly 6,000 physicians, residents, and medical students in family medicine across the state. Family medicine physicians have the unique opportunity to take care of patients of all ages, from birth until end of life, pediatrics to geriatrics, and to understand the complex connections that influence an individual's health, connections between their physical and mental health, connections between an individual and their family, and connections between their individuals and their communities. In family medicine, we recognize that eating disorders can manifest as a chronic disease, they can newly manifest among adults, and those diagnosed and treated in childhood may experience recurrences throughout their adulthood. People with eating disorders need access to treatment options to support recovery throughout their lifetime. I'm here to represent some of the ways in which family medicine physicians work with our patients with eating disorders. My specific background is as a board-certified family medicine physician with an expertise in working with people who've experienced abuse-related trauma, particularly human trafficking. In 2015, I founded the Purple Clinic, a family medicine practice in New York City that was designed to provide long-term care for people who'd experienced human trafficking, domestic violence, sexual assault, and other forms of abuse-related trauma, as well as the children of survivors. I provided care for over 300 patients of all genders, of all documentation statuses, from the US and abroad, people with and without insurance, and the majority of whom were living in shelters or were experiencing homelessness. Histories of trauma, particularly sexual trauma, are associated with eating disorders, and this was evident with the patients I was working with in clinic. An example of the type of referral that came into Purple Clinic from a community-based organization would state, "Hello, Dr. Ravi. I'm working with an adult trafficking victim who has a long history of bulimia and anorexia. She denies that she's currently purging or restricting, but reports that she feels she's having obsessive thoughts and other symptoms relating to her disease. Do you have anyone on staff at the moment that specializes in eating disorders? She's very motivated to work with someone, but she does not have insurance and has not been able to find a provider thus far. Any referrals would be greatly appreciated. Thank you." Over the last 4 years, several of my patients have had diagnoses of eating disorders, but we chronically struggled in connecting them with necessary services. In caring for the children of survivors, I also had the opportunity to provide pediatric well-child visits for children ranging from infancy to adults and to screen for eating disorders. I look forward to sharing information today that I hope will expand the reach and scope of your efforts in this important medical issue. So first, regarding S-5870, there are several points of feedback that we'd like to provide for this legislation as it's currently written. The primary one is with regard to the phrase, "The commissioner shall promulgate any rules and regulations necessary to implement the provisions of this section." It's important to note that in the rationale section for this legislation, it states that while the American Academy of Pediatrics recommends screening for eating disorders should be a part of routine annual care, some busy pediatric practices do not consistently implement screening. This is an important issue that needs to be addressed. The issue is not always that pediatricians or family medicine physicians are not aware that we should screen for eating disorders. In fact, included here is a checklist of all of the screenings that are recommended for routine physicals. This one I included was examples of children ages 11 through 14. And you can see anticipatory guidance should include discussing interpersonal violence, domestic violence, living situation, and food security, family substance abuse, school performances, coping with stress and decision making, family rules, routines, concerns for others, patience and control over anger, oral health, body image, healthy eating, physical activity and sleep, mood regulation and mental health, sexuality, pregnancy and sexually transmitted infections, tobacco and substance use, acoustic trauma, seatbelt and helmet use, sun protection, substance use and riding in a vehicle, firearm safety. And this doesn't include a lot of the new things that are coming up, like cyberbullying and other ways to be able to make sure we're appropriately counseling the patients that we work with. The issue is we physicians find ourselves often trapped between knowing all of the things we need to do and doing them successfully within the constraints of the healthcare system's prioritization of volume of patients and other metrics that become barriers to individualized care delivery. Creating a commission that established best practice protocol for early screening of children for eating disorders will not solve this problem. Time, money, and innovative efforts must instead be focused on ways to support clinicians in our efforts to do right by our patients within these systems barriers. Furthermore, this legislation assumes only pediatricians provide care for children and that the American Academy of Pediatrics is the sole source of guidelines that physicians use when practicing pediatric care. As family medicine physicians, we also provide pediatric care, and our academy relies on evidence-based recommendations from a variety of sources, including the United States Preventive Services Task Force, when determining the standard of care. Screening for eating disorders can and should also occur outside of the healthcare system. As an example, I recently completed a continuing medical education course focused on addressing mental health in community-based settings, which was administered by the American Board of Family Medicine. One of the multiple choice questions asked, a local school district asked for your assistance in developing a screening program for eating disorders in schools. You advise that screening programs are effective when A, performed at a healthcare provider's office, B, performed at a high school, C, limited to females, D, limited to those with a BMI of less than 25, or E, limited to high-risk racial and ethnic groups. The correct answer was B, performed at a high school, which surprised some of the attendees because some people thought performed at a healthcare provider's office would have been the right answer. But the rationale was that access to healthcare can be limited, but there's a greater probability of reaching more children who may be affected by implementing the screening program at a high school than within a usual healthcare provider's office. This approach to screening is critical education for physicians, as well as for legislators, to ensure that you support investment in screening-related policy both effectively and broadly. For Bill S-5869, such an awareness campaign as outlined in this legislation can certainly be helpful to raise general public awareness on this important issue. As such, several aspects should be considered in the design of this awareness campaign based on our clinical experience. The first is educating non-health sectors on eating disorders. So multi-sector education on eating disorders is also critical because patients with eating disorders sometimes live in shelters or group homes. Because diagnoses and management of eating disorders are typically made as collaborative efforts with the observations and inputs from parents, from for pediatric patients in non-traditional housing settings, this responsibility lies on the shelter staff. My clinical experience has revealed challenges for patients living in shelter settings because of misunderstandings of eating disorder management and support among staff. Miseducation in this area has led to policing of my patients' food intake and medications, and punitive consequences if they appear to be non-adherent to assumed treatment plans, resulting in ongoing harm to patients' ability to sustain recovery. Well-intentioned efforts were rooted in a dangerously superficial understanding of eating disorders, harming patients' long-term well-being. Thus, eating disorder campaigns must make sure to include educating related stakeholders, such as school, housing programs, and foster care agencies on this issue, to ensure that our patients have a community safety net as they address this chronic disease. The second is ensuring access to programs regardless of insurance status. So far too often, my patients who are experiencing a recurrence of their eating disorder could not access the level of care and support that they needed. Patients expressed frustration that they were either too sick or not sick enough for programs that their insurance would cover. For example, one patient who was struggling with bulimia was told that she was not sick enough for inpatient treatment, but her insurance wouldn't cover the cost of her entering an outpatient treatment program because she was too sick to qualify. To qualify, she would have to say she was purging less, restricting less, and not taking diuretics. The cost of that insurance coverage was $400 a day, which was prohibitively expensive for her to engage in care. So she initiated an insurance appeals process and waited until she became sick enough to qualify for inpatient care, impacting her job, her income, and of course, her overall health. In summary, from a family medicine perspective, we see eating disorders as a chronic condition that can impact our pediatric patients throughout their lifetime, as well as our adult patients. We believe that addressing eating disorders requires support outside of the realm of legislative mandates to ensure that the evidence-based guidelines regarding screening that we're all familiar with can be appropriately implemented. To have a true impact, this work must extend beyond the healthcare system and include other sectors that can engage in identification and care of people with eating disorders. And those who are ultimately identified must be able to connect with accessible, both timely and affordable treatment options. So in closing, the New York State Academy of Family Physicians thanks you again for conducting hearings on this important medical and public health issue of eating disorders, treatment, and recovery.
Thank you. So just some questions.
Yes.
I was a little confused on for the screening,
yes.
Because you give us an example, or you gave me an example of all the things that physicians try to screen for, but aren't required to, But if they have time, they do it.
Well, they're supposed to. So when someone comes in for an annual well child, these are the things, like in our electronic medical record, we have to make sure that all of these things get hit in that visit. Mm-hmm. So technically, these are all issues that should be addressed, and we're supposed to give the appropriate handout. So they're not a choice. They're like the standard of care.
But are they doing it?
So that's what I worry about. I guess there are so many things that... I think there's a difference between, in theory, checking a click box and how effective it is. I see this all the time, right, with domestic violence screening. You can look at a screen and say, do you feel safe at home? Do you do this? But there's a difference between asking and looking at someone and how you ask the question and how engaged you look and how caring you are Sure. about the response. And so I think that disconnect sometimes is tough, because even if there are sheets that say now school physicals, we all have to mandate, like, screening for eating disorders, I can see how people would be like, yes, I gave an eating disorder prevention sheet, like this was done, this was done. Mm-hmm. So, but I think at the same time, it isn't that people don't care. I think it's hard, because when I find out there's three big issues with my patients, that they are being bullied and bad things are happening, I want that time and space to be able to talk to them. And it's, I don't know what the right answer is, because at the same time, we're like, oh, there's four patients still waiting for you. You have to do this. And every time you bring someone back, it's more of an investment on their time, time away from school. So I don't know what the right answer is, but I know that often when we see things that are mandated, it doesn't actually change the result on the ground, because we already know that these things matter and we need to be doing them. We definitely need more support. A lot of the programs people described in educating people, a lot of my education came after I was running this clinic, because I understood my patients taught me the ways they would hide quarters in their bras, like when they were doing their weights, because they didn't, you know, I had to change how I did my vitals, so that patients first, I would talk to them and we'd do vitals last, because if they had eating disorders, that weight could disrupt the rest of the visit and we couldn't get to other things. So there's a lot that I learned from my patients, and that having support resources here would be excellent, but I'm not sure that like a mandate in doing it would translate into that effectiveness that matters for all of us, I guess.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your testimony.
Sure.
Thank you. Great, and next we're gonna hear from Miriam Sherpin. Miriam Sherpin. I don't know if she's here. I guess not. Okay. We're going to go to Charlotte Williams, eating disorder advocate. Okay. Mm-hmm. John, just change the name. Thank you, Miriam.
Hi, thank you for having me. I wanna thank Shavis for inviting me. So my name is Charlotte Williams. I was just 12 when I began to diet. I initially believed I was doing it in the pursuit of health, a convenient lie I could tell myself and others around me to mask the reality that all I wanted was to desperately lose weight. I had become convinced that my body, a body which was not yet fully formed, was fundamentally broken and needed to be fixed. This belief system led me to develop an eating disorder, which would dominate every aspect of my life, no matter how big or small, for the next 9 years. I was even younger when I was 12 when I learned that to the world we live in, weight gain is something to be feared. My mother was a religious dieter and my father was an over-exerciser. I became, like all of us, unconsciously inundated in a world of diet culture. As a child, I envied the impossibly thin, airbrushed women I saw in the media. I felt the fear of calories lurking around every corner. I pilfered snacks from the pantry by hiding them in the waistband of my pajama pants. In middle school, I stayed up until 3 a.m. so I could watch the weight loss infomercials that would guarantee you a glittering, perfect life if only you could lose those last few pounds. Food and what kind of food I ate became a moral decision that affected every area of my life. My eating disorder began by cutting out all the foods society had deemed unhealthy, immoral, or sinful. Like all things with eating disorders, this alone would never be enough. I had to do more. Within weeks, it escalated to cutting out whole food groups, and within months, I had begun to lose a drastic amount of weight. I began to feel the side effects. When I was 12, I did not know that the body's reaction to dieting is the same as it is to famine. There is no evolutionary imperative to fitting into a smaller dress size, and yet I believed that my child body was fully equipped to handle the drastic mental and physical changes that starvation would cause. I was losing hair, I completely lost my period, I was weak, losing muscle. I would fade in and out of consciousness in school, rushing to the bathroom every time I felt woozy. My personality changed. I lost my humor and was losing excitement, and was losing all excitement I had for life and activities in order to cater to my warped need for control. All I could do was think about food, how I could avoid it, and how long I could last without it. I thought about it in school, in the car, before I went to bed. I thought about it at Thanksgiving dinner, my grandfather's funeral, my sister's birthday. I chose my eating disorder before everything and everyone in my life. Initially, my eating disorder was ignored by my family. In the world we live in, weight loss is nearly always congratulated, even in children. My father applauded my newer, greener diet. My mother bought me new sets of clothes. My best friend's family lauded me for, quote, finally losing my baby weight. I was furious, angry, and encouraged to keep hurting myself. I thought, how could no one see what was happening to me? The horrible restrict binge cycle lasted for another 9 years. It carried me through the rest of middle school, into high school, and well into college. It saw me through the falling out of lifelong friendships, breakups, and heartache of all kind. It felt like my eating disorder had a longer lifespan than anything or anyone in my life. It was my dearest, most trusted friend, and also my worst enemy. Not until last year, the summer that I turned 21, did I fully acknowledge the severity of my problem and entered treatment. Only there did I begin the long and painful journey of repairing my relationship to food, my body, and myself. Despite how they are portrayed in the media, eating disorders are not a show of willpower, discipline, or resolve. They are instead a complete and total loss of those things. It is the absence of agency when its victim is so desperately in search of it. To commit to the rituals and thought patterns that the illness requires to thrive is to relinquish power, control, and trust of the body and all its instinct. When my illness was in its formative years, I was a young person desperate to find an identity, something whole and sturdy I could cling to. I found that in my eating disorder. I found purpose and reason, a logical mythology that made sense only to me. My eating disorder gave me a new language, one without words, a way I could communicate my distress to the ones around me by physically shrinking away. My eating disorder started as a way to gain some semblance of control, but was ultimately a way to manage my anxiety and cope with an uncertain and terrifying world. Towards the very beginning of my recovery, my first dietitian told me to keep a photo of myself as a baby in my wallet, that whenever I felt the compulsion to speak cruelly to myself or whenever I wanted to restrict to look at that photo and ask, would I be as mean to that little girl as I am being to myself right now? You have to hate a person so much to want to starve them. It is an impossibly tragic and ultimately preventable tragedy that so many young people cannot see another way. I am one of the incredibly privileged few who was able to receive treatment for my eating disorder. I'm incredibly grateful for the opportunity and the access to the resources that facilitated my recovery, knowing well that not everyone is able to get the chance that I did. It is the incredible fault of the kind of shame culture that we live in, however, that it took myself as long as it did to seek out help at all. As a 12-year-old girl, I was entirely uneducated on eating disorders, how to detect them, and what kind of permanent physical, mental, and emotional impact they can have on a person. For a mental illness which can affect so many young individuals, there is no excuse for this. We have a moral obligation as adults to teach young people that their bodies, their minds, their hearts are not the problem. It is rather the society that we live in, so steeped in diet culture and food shame, that is teaching us there is something we must fear inside ourselves. Eating disorder awareness and education has come so far in just the past few decades, but until we mobilize and enact real legislative change, eating disorders for so many will remain undiagnosed, untreated, and misunderstood. Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, Charlie, thank you so much for sharing your story. It's very powerful, and we really appreciate it.
Thank you.
And if you don't mind me asking now, you mentioned at 12, and is that when you believe that you first started with the eating disorder?
Yeah, I would say that was when the restrictive tendencies started when I started to actually manipulate food intake.
And how long was it before you realized that you had an actual eating disorder or that you were actually diagnosed?
Yeah, so I wasn't formally diagnosed until I was like 19. Mm-hmm. I'm 22 now. Mm-hmm. But I believe I started to kind of consume media about eating disorders. But it's also the kind of media that I'm talking about that's very, like, glamorizing and kind of, like, not quite...
Clinical or scientific?
Yeah, not quite as what I would consider now to be reputable sources. Mm-hmm. And I started to kind of like understand what that was maybe when I was like 15 or 16 mm-hmm. and understand that like mm-hmm. something deeper was going on then.
Wow. And how did you, and it was it when you were 19, you were diagnosed, and is that when you got the treatment that you needed?
When I was 19, I started going to a therapist, and then a year later, I started seeing a dietitian, and they diagnosed me with anorexia binge purge type, which I also, at the time, feel like was a misdiagnosis because I had never exhibited symptoms of purging. Mm-hmm. So that, I think, was also a fault of the medical system. So I also took a really long time to actually seek treatment, and it wasn't until like last summer that I reached out and entered an outpatient program.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Excellent. And are you part of a, as Dr. Crapy had talked about, a like a peer mentoring support group with your outpatient?
I do. I have been in a DBT group for a while, and then I was also in eating disorder treatment is like highly group therapy based. Mm-hmm. So I was in that for a bit. And then I also do go to like a weekly support group, but it's mostly like other eating disorder sufferers mm-hmm. or people in recovery.
Right. Well, thank you so much for your testimony. And I look forward to working with you. And thank you for sharing your story. It's extremely powerful. And it's really I think it's so helpful to so many others to see that, hey, you know, I'm not alone. And that there is help there, and you can go on to live a very productive life. So, Charlotte, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. Take care. And next we have Miriam Shurpin who is a registered dietitian. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to allow me to speak to you regarding an issue that I see repeatedly through the work that I do and my proposal to possibly prevent this in the future. So as you know, my name is Miriam Shurpin, and I work as a registered dietitian. I run a private practice in Pomona here in New York, where, unfortunately, the majority of the clients I see suffer from disordered eating or eating disorders. I have clients coming into my office from all backgrounds, ages, genders, etc., and their disordered eating and eating disorders have many multifaceted causes. But there's one role that really, one influence in particular that stands out to me across the board and very often. And that is the role that their parents have played in their now negative body image and their unhealthy relationship with food. So from being constantly compared to a sibling who has a smaller build than they do and being told that you must watch what you eat as a result, and that then being a contributing factor to their bulimia nervosa, or being told they cannot be part of family celebrations in terms of having a piece of cake or any of the junk food because they may one day become fat. And that then leading towards constant cravings and binge eating down the line. Or simply being told by a caring parent that they will only find love if they lose weight first. And that being a contributing factor towards their now anorexia nervosa. So I know that these parents had the noblest intentions and they wanted the best for their child. And in a culture that perceives smaller bodies as healthier and worthier, I don't blame any of them for thinking and doing what they did. Subsequently, what I am proposing is that parents be made aware and educated on what it actually means to have a positive body image and a healthy relationship with food for both themselves and for their children. What that practically looks like on a day-to-day basis, and how the long-term effects of more confidence, positive health outcomes, and a more positive a more positive body image occurs as a result. And then on the flip side, what happens when somebody has a negative body image, a negative relationship with food, and how research shows that very likely will lead to negative health consequences, not an unhealthy BMI, and lower self-confidence. Now, there are numerous ways in which bringing about this awareness and education to parents could actually be put into practice. One such example would be to target parents who are attending their child's six-month well visit, because this is a time where parents are generally putting their children on solid food. So at the, you know, being there at the with the pediatrician at the well visit, if let's say there was a standardized video clip that was shown to all parents across the state, along with appropriate resources for them to then go and educate themselves further in this area, I believe it would contribute greatly towards building a more positive relationship with food and body image from early on. And I believe that if this proposal could be implemented, it would play a vital role in the prevention of disordered eating and eating disorders down the line. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate that. And we look forward to working with you. Thank you. Appreciate it. And next we're gonna hear from Susan Ribbert, who is an eating disorder advocate.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you, Susan.
Thanks.
Good to see you.
My name is Susan Vibbert, and I'm very thankful to have the opportunity to speak here today in support of bills S-5869 and S-5870, as well as the proposed bills related to the school curriculum on eating disorders and the recognition of eating disorders by the Office of Mental Health. I'm very grateful for Senator Carlucci's leadership on these issues and very excited for the positive impact I believe can come from bills such as these. After struggling with eating disorders for most of my life, I've been in strong recovery from anorexia, bulimia, binge eating disorder for several years. I'm now an advocate for eating disorder prevention and treatment and on the board of the National Eating Disorders Association. I'm also the mother of three children attending the New York Public Schools, with a ninth grader, a seventh grader, and a fourth grader. So the topic of eating disorder prevention and early detection and treatment is of really high importance to me. As we've heard, eating disorders are estimated to impact 30 million people throughout their lifetimes, and this number is likely widely underestimated due to the lack of diagnostic screening and the myths that surround how someone with an eating disorder will present. Eating disorders can have serious consequences on the mental and physical health of those impacted, and as we've heard, they have the second highest mortality rate of any mental health issues. Yet, eating disorder awareness remains low, and there's essentially no screening or prevention in place for those at risk. This is why I'm so strongly in support of S-5869, which establishes the New York State Joint Eating Disorder Awareness Campaign and the Awareness Campaign Fund to elevate awareness about eating disorders throughout New York State. I'm also in support of S-5870, which requires the establishment of best practice protocols for screening of children for eating disorders by pediatric primary care providers. I believe that providing pediatric doctors with education on eating disorders, prevention, and screening can have a really meaningful preventative effect. Unfortunately, the pediatrician's office is often the catalyst for the beginning of an eating disorder. And through my own recovery, through my advocacy, and as a parent of three children, I've heard countless stories of people linking the beginning of their disordered dieting and eating behaviors to a pediatrician's comment on BMI, growth curve trajectory, or the need for weight loss. Establishing best practice protocols of eating disorder screening could meaningfully change this dynamic so that rather than a pediatric doctor visit serving as the catalyst for disordered eating behavior, in those at risk, it becomes another tool in the prevention and early identification of eating disorders. I'm also very excited to see potential legislation around a standardized health class curriculum on eating disorders. Similar to the pediatrician's office, I've seen and heard countless tales of well-meaning teachers inadvertently providing the catalyst for disordered eating behaviors in those at risk. My own children have had homework assignments where they were required to categorize foods as good foods or bad foods, where they were asked to lie about their age and sign up for the weight loss app like MyFitnessPal and track their calorie consumption for a month, where they were weighed in front of their peers at school. I've also seen children provided with fad information about diet and weight loss as if it were fact. Body sizes vary very dramatically and naturally at this age due to the different rates of growth and the different age onset of puberty. But these varying body sizes, coupled with our society's increasing fascination with a singular body ideal, puts children at increased risk for eating disorders. If done correctly, a standardized curriculum on eating disorder prevention could be such a powerful prevention tool. But it would require educating students and teachers and parents and the society at large, frankly, on the harmful effects of body shame, weight stigma, and diet culture. So thank you again for the opportunity to be here, and specifically to you, Senator Carlucci, for championing this issue of eating disorder awareness, prevention, and treatment. As an advocate in the eating disorder community, I know that I and so many others are thankful for your attention to this area, and look forward to working with you to make New York State a leader in eating disorder prevention and treatment.
Well, Susan, thank you for sharing that, and thank you for sharing your story. And I think, and I'm thankful to you, because that's what's keeping this going, is that we share these experiences and these stories so we know where the pitfalls are, what's going on. You know, as the clinicians, we and the politicians, we can talk about it, but we really need you and Hannah and Charlotte and people like you to tell your story, and I'm so grateful for that. Thank you.
Thank you.
And next we have Robin Wallace, clinical social worker and therapist from... Oh, okay, she's not here. So we have Christine Knorr from the Rockland Jewish Family Service. And I've been fortunate to be in the presence of Christine when she's presenting on eating disorders in the community. So thank you, and thank you for being here.
Thank you so much. I was actually just about to mention that, and thank you for your support over the last several years. And it doesn't go unnoticed, and as well as your ongoing support for mental health in general.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So my name is Christine Knorr, and I'm a New York State licensed clinical social worker, certified eating disorder specialist, and therapist with 12 years of experience. I'm the co-founder and chairperson of the Rockland Eating Disorders Task Force, which is made up of physicians, therapists, community philanthropists, and other professionals with an interest in helping those with eating disorders. I teach a class on eating disorders at Dominican College, and I've worked in private practice, nonprofit, and clinic settings, providing therapy to people with eating disorders, as well as teaching and supervising other professionals. The most common misconception I see across the board is that eating disorders are all about vanity, wanting to look like your favorite celebrity, or wanting to arbitrarily exert control over food. I'm here to tell you that not only is this belief false, but that the public perception of this belief keeps those who are suffering with a life-threatening illness from seeking help and from getting the life-saving treatment they need. Eating disorders are serious mental health conditions that are highly genetic and neurobiologically based. Proposed legislation relating to New York State and the Office of Mental Health recognizing or including eating disorders as a mental health condition should be adopted without question. Eating disorders have been included in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, and thus legitimizing them as a mental disorder diagnosed by medical and mental health professionals since 1980. So this is really archaic that it hasn't been adopted yet. Yeah. According to research by the National Association of Anorexia and Associated Disorders, every 62 minutes, at least one person dies as a direct result of an eating disorder. Living with an eating disorder means decreased productivity at school and work, a disruption in family relationships, as well as a host of related medical and mental health issues, such as major depressive disorder, self-harm behaviors, and debilitating anxiety. A person with an eating disorder is at risk for heart attack, infertility, osteoporosis, tooth decay, and other pervasive lifelong health problems. These problems do not affect only individuals and their families. When over 30 million individuals of all ages and gender suffer from an eating disorder, the entire population is affected. It is incumbent upon the state of New York to decrease the population of eating disorder sufferers for the good of individuals and of a healthy, productive society. Research has overwhelmingly shown that early detection and proper treatment predict the best prognosis. When these elements are in place, full recovery from an eating disorder is possible. In my experience as a therapist and certified eating disorder specialist, the longer the eating disorder goes undetected or when appropriate treatment is delayed, the likelihood that the person will suffer lifelong consequences increases exponentially. A lack of understanding and education on the part of teachers, coaches, and even physicians has led to people not being referred to appropriate treatment early enough. Kids are simply not being identified. Students themselves may not recognize that their dangerous behaviors are a problem because it's not being discussed enough in schools, and sometimes parents just don't know what to look for. Stereotypes we all picture about what an eating disorder sufferer looks like, maybe a white, middle-class teen girl, can prevent other people, minorities, those who do not suffer from anorexia nervosa, adults, and those in all social classes, from recognizing their problem and seeking help for it. This is why statewide education campaigns are crucially important. In over a decade as a therapist and having treated hundreds of patients with eating disorders, I've had the privilege of hearing their stories about how their eating disorder developed. A common theme is how receiving messages from adults about health, diet, and weight loss has impacted them. Receiving information that is developmentally inappropriate or inaccurate can cause psychological harm. One person told me about how watching the documentary Super Size Me in health class triggered obsessive thoughts about food that led to a cycle of self-starvation and binge eating. Another told me about how hearing her teacher's restrictive diet plan day after day triggered her own obsession with calorie counting that led to the development of anorexia nervosa, of course, among other psychological factors and predispositions. It wasn't that alone, but that was certainly a catalyst. Yet another told me about how reading excerpts from a so-called memoir about a woman who had suffered from an eating disorder as a class assignment gave her ideas about how to induce vomiting. These stories highlight the need for standardized statewide health class curriculum on eating disorders that provides developmentally appropriate information that is sensitive to the needs of students who may be psychologically vulnerable to developing an eating disorder. One of the most important aspects of my job as a certified eating disorder specialist has been to provide workshops, talks, and prevention programming to the community. I've had the privilege of going into schools and speaking to groups of students about healthy body image, how to recognize the signs of an eating disorder, and how to get help for themselves or a friend who may be struggling. I had an experience I'd like to share with you. It highlights the need for programs such as these. A few years ago, I was speaking to a group of middle schoolers. After my presentation, a girl, we'll call Jenny, approached me. Jenny told me that she had been dieting for a few months and had recently started forcing herself to vomit after lunch and dinner. She was scared and had not told anyone. Jenny did not know before my presentation that this behavior was not normal and that it was in fact dangerous. She already felt out of control. She had tried to stop on her own, but found she couldn't. Together, Jenny and I approached the school social worker who contacted her mother. A week later, Jenny and her parents started counseling with me. Today, she's a bright and healthy high school athlete with plans to attend college next year. She's found her way out of her eating disorder and no longer feels hopeless and confused. Jenny's story had a happy ending, but so many don't. Too many kids suffer in silence for too long as their behaviors become increasingly dangerous and out of control. In the partial hospitalization program where I once worked as a clinician and supervisor, I saw too many women in their 50s and even 60s who never got proper treatment when their eating disorder started, and now they feel little hope for recovery. These are people we all know, our parents, our siblings, our neighbors, our friends, smart, caring, accomplished people who did not have access to the information and screening that may have informed a completely different outcome, the promise of a healthy life.
Great, thank you, Christine.
Thank you, thank you.
And I was a little distracted. You were talking about OMH, and they haven't updated since 1980. Could you reference that again?
I was referencing the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders,
DSM.
Which is widely used by physicians and mental health professionals to diagnose various mental health conditions. Mm-hmm. And eating disorders have actually been in there since 1980.
Without being updated?
It's been updated quite a few times over the years.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. So you weren't being critical. You were just saying that.
Yes. It's a known thing. Eating mm-hmm. disorders are already widely accepted as mental health conditions.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying
that.
Sure. Yes. Mm-hmm. And thank you for sharing those stories. And the example of Jenny that you mentioned, now I imagine you bring that up because you say that, and it was talked about before, that we believe that 90% of children with an eating disorder in New York State alone go undiagnosed.
Okay.
And she, I guess you're saying she had access, she saw you, she was able to come to a presentation,
right,
and it opened up her ability to get help.
Right. She received age-appropriate, accurate information. Otherwise, she
was
may
that through
have,
her school district or?
Yeah, that was actually through a program that you had sponsored.
Oh, great!
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so I was able to do that as part of my job, to present to schools and things like that, different groups and organizations. So it was through that program. You know, she received some information about what eating disorders are, mm-hmm. rather than what she may have seen on TV or right. heard from her peers, or, you know, there's a lot of inaccurate stereotypes and misinformation out there. So she actually received information that brought to light some of her own behaviors. She did not know prior to hearing this presentation that what she was doing was not normal, was dangerous, mm-hmm. et cetera. And she was able to approach me and say, you know, I'm really scared about this. I didn't know, and I tried to stop, and now I'm scared. And so, yeah. So she was able to get help right away.
Yeah, okay, excellent.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, thank you so much for your testimony. Yeah. Really appreciate it.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you. And that completes my list of people testifying. I don't think did I miss anyone? Well, I just want to thank everyone for participating today. This went very, very smoothly, and it was very enlightening to hear. I think we crossed many different issues, starting, you know, Dr. Horder's talking about the two tracks with Medicaid and insurance, to making sure that we have age-appropriate education and curriculum, to supporting the legislation and some possible critiques, and making sure that these issues are being addressed first and foremost. Our goal is, from the testimony here today, and we're also encouraging anyone that didn't get to speak today to send us testimony. You can, as simple as sending us an email or giving us a phone call, and making sure that your experience, your suggestion is heard. And we look forward to formulating a report and having not just the two bills that we mentioned here that we talked about thoroughly today, but many of the other things that we've been working on that were talked about, and also some of the suggestions that we heard here today. And we look forward to having this robust agenda so we can get it on the Mental Health Committee agenda and get this legislation passed as soon as possible so that we can start making sure that New York is a leader. You know, one of the things, I've been involved with the National Conference of State Legislators, and as my role as chairman of the Mental Health Committee, I've been able to travel around to other states and meet to other lawmakers, and I realize that we have a long road ahead of us when we talk about mental illness. But I also realize that we are far ahead of many other states. And I don't say that to criticize other states. I say it to make sure that in New York that we have a responsibility. You know, we're called the Empire State. We serve 19 million people from every background on the face of the globe. And we have a responsibility to lead a path forward. And I think when we talk about this issue of eating disorders, how serious it is, we've talked about the statistics about how, unfortunately, every 62 minutes someone passes away, how it's one of the leading causes of mortality for someone living with mental illness. But yet in this day and age, it's often not talked about. It's something that maybe it's talked about in a quick snippet because we hear about a celebrity, but we haven't had a robust conversation in our schools. And education is one of the most important things and responsibilities as a state senator and, of course, as a parent. We teach our kids all types of things, you know, how to read and write, but emotional intelligence and eating disorders and that body image is something that's often left off the table. But I think that's something that has to be first and foremost. And look forward to working with all of you. I appreciate the critiques to the legislation. I appreciate the support and all the other information that we heard today. We look forward to having that robust report so that we can move on this legislation and look forward to working with each of you as partners in that effort. So again, thank you for being here. And with that, this hearing on mental, this hearing of the Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities Committee regarding eating disorders is adjourned. Thank you so much.